Okay, carrying on, 1 Corinthians. In chapter 9, I've said a number of times, Paul responds to those who were resisting his prohibition of eating at these temple feasts, and they are resisting it there by calling into question his apostolic authority. Then at the end of chapter 9, in verses 24 to 27, Paul moves from his defending his apostleship against their criticism of his choices, he moves to exhorting them to put great effort into Christian living. And he's turning the subject back to their insistence on eating the cultic meals in the temples. Being faithful to Christ, it requires discipline, self-denial, and self-control. And then in chapter 10, verses 1 to 5, Paul stresses through the example of the ancient Israelites that the Corinthians' baptism and sharing in the Lord's Supper will not save them if they continue to defy him by participating in the cultic feasts in the pagan temples. And then in chapter 10, verses 6 through 10, he first warns them generally not to follow Israel's example of lusting after evil things. And then he warns them specifically not to follow Israel's example of idolatry, putting Christ to the test, and grumbling and complaining, all of which they were doing in their insistence on participating in the temple feasts. In chapter 10, verses 11 and 12, he says that those attending the cultic meals with a mistaken sense of security, those who think they're standing firm, they need to wake up to the danger. And then in chapter 10, verse 13, he reassures the congregation that the grave danger of which he's speaking is not posed by a testing that overtakes them, by situations and circumstances that come upon them in life. God will always provide a way out in those cases, meaning he will provide a way for saints to endure that testing without falling. But there's no escape for what one chooses to do. For one who refuses to accept the avenue of escape God has provided, precisely because one is choosing to do it. Now, when we ended, we were looking at chapter 10, verses 14 to 22, where Paul says flat out that they have to stop attending the temple meals. I'll read it again, maybe repeat something of what I said, and then we'll go on. He says, "Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to wise men. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a sharing of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ? Because there's one bread, we the many are one body, for all partake of the one bread. Consider Israel according to the flesh. Are not those who eat the sacrifices sharers of the altar? What then am I saying? That things sacrificed to idols are anything, or that an idol is anything? To the contrary, I'm saying that the things which they sacrifice to demons and not to a God. And I do not want you to be sharers of demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Or should we try to provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he?" Now, given the danger of falling that is posed by choosing the wrong, by refusing the avenue of escape that God provides, Paul concludes in verse 14. He says, "Therefore, they have to flee from idolatry." He then uses their knowledge of the nature of the Lord's Supper and their knowledge of the nature of the Old Testament sacred meals to show how sensible his prohibition is. It's quite sensible. Just as participation in the Lord's Supper is an act of worship, just as sharing in the meal following the sacrifices in the Old Testament was a sharing in the sacrificial worship of Yahweh, So eating these cultic meals in these pagan temples is also a sharing in the worship of the idol. It's not simply eating a meal. The context creates this worship element there. And he says in verses 19 and 20, he clarifies his argument to make clear that he is not implying that the idols to whom sacrifices are offered in pagan temples, that they're actually gods. That there's actually Zeus or Apollos or any of these. He's not implying that they're actually gods. He and the Corinthians are in complete agreement that there is only one God. Rather, his point is that though they're not gods, they do represent demonic powers. You see, demonic powers are ultimately behind these things, and Paul doesn't want them to be sharers in sacrificial offerings to demons. And in verse 21, Paul both warns and he prohibits them. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. You can't do it. So Christians who are sharing in the Lord's table have no business sharing in the table and the cup of demons. And in verse 22 he asks, or should we try to provoke the Lord to jealousy? See, meaning, will you continue eating at both meals and thus arouse the Lord's jealousy as Israel did in the desert? Are you going to do that? And he lets them know, you're not going to win that battle, by the way. When he says, are we stronger than he? The answer is, no, you're not. So if you're going to get in a throwdown with God, you're coming out on the short end. So Paul asks him that. Then he says in 10:23 to 11:1, he's going to take up a different subject where he says, all things are lawful, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of the other. Eat everything sold in the meat market, questioning nothing on account of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and the fullness of it. That's Psalm 24:1. If one of the unbelievers invites you and you want to go, eat everything that is set before you, questioning nothing on account of conscience. But if anyone says to you, this meat is offered in sacrifice, do not eat on account of that person who pointed it out and on account of conscience. I mean not one's own conscience, but the conscience of the other. For why is my freedom being judged by the conscience of another? If I partake with gratitude, why am I reviled because of that for which I give thanks? Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all things to the glory of God. Be not a stumbling block to Jews, to Greeks, or to the church of God, even as I also try to please all men in all things, not seeking my own advantage, but the advantage of many, so that they may be saved. Be imitators of me, as I also am of Christ. Now, Paul says here, having finished this discussion that he's been on about eating in the temple meals, eating in these cultic meals in the pagan temples, he finished that discussion with a strong reiteration of his prohibition. Remember, he had prohibited them, they pushed back, he's been prohibiting them again. He finishes that discussion with this strong reiteration of his prohibition in chapter 10, verses 14 to 22. And he now addresses the subject of sacrificed meat that is later sold in the marketplace for home consumption. See, we're no longer in the temple feast as part of this worship ritual of this idol and sharing in that. We're now in a case of where the sacrificial meat then gets not used, gets sold in the temple and is purchased for home consumption. Now, Paul spoke about that in more general terms in chapter 9, verses 19 to 23, in the context of defending himself against the charge of hypocrisy for abstaining from eating such meat sometimes and not abstaining at other times. So you remember that he was accused there of, well, you seem to be going both ways. You seem to lack principle. So he addressed this generally in that context of defending himself against that charge. He returns to the subject here in more detail, not simply to explain his own conduct, but to provide guidance for the behavior of others. And he spells out the Christian's freedom and responsibility regarding sacrificed meat in a non-temple setting. And in the process, he provides further explanation for his own actions. The rule in such cases, the rule is indeed freedom. See, just as the Corinthians quoted slogan indicated, but Paul reminds them, as he has in other contexts, that their freedom is not absolute. It has to be qualified by a concern for the welfare of other people. The principle of freedom is clearly declared in verses 25 to 27. Eat everything sold in the meat market, questioning nothing on account of conscience, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness of it. If one of the unbelievers invites you and you want to go, eat everything set before you, questioning nothing on account of conscience. So the principle of freedom is clearly declared there. The Christian is free to eat everything sold in the meat market. Before buying it, the Christian is not to investigate the meat's history for possible religious contamination. I'm over here at the butcher saying, and where'd you get that? Can you give me a pedigree on that? Can you make sure that I can trust that it has never been tainted by some pagan ritual in any way, shape, or form? He says that's not necessary, that the Christian is not to do that. God is the ultimate source of all food. That's what he means. That's what's suggested by his reference to Psalm 24:1. Even food that was previously offered in sacrifice. And the principle is that nothing that is done to food makes the food itself taboo. Nothing that's done to the food makes the food itself taboo, as opposed to the context in which the food is eaten. You see, if you're going to participate in a pagan worship ritual in the pagan temple, well, we're now talking about something else. It is not the food per se that's the problem. It is the context in which you're eating that food. So when it's taken out of that context and purchased for home consumption in the marketplace, the food itself is not taboo. You don't have to worry about it. See, likewise, the Christian who accepts an unbeliever's invitation. See, the Christian's free to eat anything. The food itself is not taboo. And then he says, likewise, that the Christian who accepts an unbeliever's invitation to dinner is free to eat whatever is served without conducting any kind of investigation into the food's origin. So an unbeliever invites you, you go to eat, he's serving up meat. You're free to eat it without doing the same kind of thing that he was talking about doing at the butcher shop. You don't have to ask the host, where did this come from? Can you give me guarantees that nothing has happened to it in terms of a pagan ritual? All food is acceptable for eating, regardless of what somebody may have done to it along the way. Food per se is not to be a matter of Christian conscience. But if somebody attending the dinner at the unbeliever's house privately, that's implied in the word, if somebody there privately comes up and informs you, the Christian, that the meat was offered in sacrifice, then the qualification of freedom comes into play. And Paul says, in that case, the Christian is to abstain. Now, it is probable that this hypothetical informant, who comes up to you and informs you, the Christian, that, hey, that's been offered in sacrifice. It is probable that that hypothetical informant is himself an unbeliever. You say, well, why do you think that? Well, it is unlikely that a Christian who objected to eating sacrificed meat would accept an invitation to a pagan dinner. But more importantly, Paul has the informant describing the meat to the Christian in pagan terminology, offered in sacrifice, rather than in Jewish Christian terminology, sacrifice to idols. So you see these things, it suggests that this unbeliever, so you're a Christian, an unbeliever has invited you to his house. He says, eat whatever's set before you. Food per se is not a matter of Christian conscience. But now we have this unbeliever who is a fellow guest at this dinner. He comes up to you and says, this has been offered in sacrifice. Verses 32 and 33, they suggest that the emphasis here, as in chapter 9, verses 19 to 23, to which Paul alludes, the emphasis is on not hindering the unbeliever's path to salvation. This unbeliever who has come up to you and said, this has been offered in sacrifice, the emphasis is on not hindering his path to salvation. The unbeliever may be trying to help the Christian out of a mistaken belief that Christians had the same view about sacrificed meat that Jews did. That's what's motivating the unbeliever. He thinks that Christians think that sacrificed meat is taboo and they can't eat it anywhere, just like Jews. So he comes up and he thinks he's helping out. In other words, the unbeliever would tip the Christian off to prevent the Christian, his fellow guest, from unwittingly violating the dietary scruples that the unbeliever mistakenly ascribes to the Christian. In other words, he has this mistaken belief that this guy has qualms about eating anything that's been sacrificed, so I better tip him off so he will be in a position to protect his conscience. That's how this guy's looking at it. An example, if you thought a fellow dinner guest, if you thought that person was religiously opposed to consuming alcohol in any form, you might tip him off that the punch was spiked. He may not know, right? I mean, you might say, you know, though, he has these scruples. You might come up and say, hey, there's alcohol in the punch. That's the idea. So here we have this unbeliever who mistakenly attributes to the Christian the same kinds of dietary scruples as Jews, thinking that they will not eat something that's been tainted by involvement with an idol. And he comes up to the Christian to spare the Christian, he thinks, and says, psst, this has been offered in sacrifice. And Paul says in that situation, the Christian is to abstain on account of the informant and conscience. And then he immediately clarifies that he means the conscience of the informant, not the Christian. The conscience of the informant. And he adds the clarification because he doesn't want somebody to conclude that having actual knowledge now imparted by the informant that this has been offered in sacrifice, that changes what he has twice already said about food not being a matter of Christian conscience. Food per se is not a matter of Christian conscience. And the fact this guy now confirmed or told you and gave you actual knowledge that this had been offered in sacrifice doesn't change a thing. You see, that doesn't change anything. It doesn't now become, oh, well, now that I know it's been offered, it doesn't matter. It could have been offered in sacrifice, sold in the meat market. The guy brings it home and you're welcome to eat it. You see, so he adds that qualification. He wants it clear that the Christian is to abstain as a matter of freedom. He's to abstain as an entitlement that he's giving up, not as a matter of conscience, not because he believes that eating that kind of meat is inherently wrong. So that's why he goes into that. The Christian is to abstain for the good of the informant, who will potentially be harmed by the Christian eating something that the informant thinks the Christian shouldn't be eating. You see, the informant can be harmed here. He's to abstain there. He can be potentially harmed by the Christian eating something that the informant, for whatever reason, however the informant got this idea, but he thinks the Christian shouldn't be eating this. And so you eat it in his presence, he could be harmed by that. This dissonance. In fact, that's when Paul speaks about conscience, he's using it in a very broad sense of moral consciousness or moral expectation, a sense of ought on the part of the informant. The informant's mistaken in ascribing to the Christian the same kinds of dietary scruples he knows Jews have, but he has that sense of ought. And if the Christian violates the informant's sense of ought, the dissonance between the informant's expectations and the Christian's practice may negatively taint the informant's view of Christianity. He will leave the thing saying, Christians are hypocrites. Now, he's mistaken in that, but that doesn't matter because he has been harmed by your going ahead and violating what he thinks Christians should be doing. So now he has a negative attitude toward Christianity. And Paul says, given that eating sacrificed food is completely optional. It is completely optional. You don't have to eat it. So why would you dare eat it in a context where you're doing so may have a negative effect on the informant, the non-Christians coming to Christ? You say, well, I like it. I want to eat it. And Paul says that cuts no ice for the Christian. That's why he's talking about discipline, self-control, I know you want to eat it. Of course you want that steak. But it's optional. So in that context, you need to abstain from eating. It's similar to Paul's decision I mentioned a couple weeks ago. In Acts chapter 16, 1 and 2, to circumcise Timothy, so as not to create an unnecessary obstacle to evangelism among the Jews. Now, if on the other hand, somebody had been insisting that abstaining from sacrificed meat was necessary for salvation, if that was the context, well, then I would expect Paul, for the welfare of other people, that he'd demand that the Christians stand for the truth of the freedom to eat the food, just as when he refused to circumcise Titus. Right in Galatians chapter 2, where he circumcises Timothy as an accommodation. But when somebody comes and says, you got to do it to be saved, then Paul says, now I can't do it. You see, because now you have put me in a context, if I do that in that setting, I'm saying you're right about that, and that's misleading, and that will damage people, and now I can't do it. Okay, it's that idea. He wants them to forego this as an accommodation for the blessing of the unbelieving informant. Now, that seems to me to be pretty far away from how we are. We would say, well, I'll tell you what the informant can do. The informant can take a hike. He's wrong, I'm right, and he can just take a hike. But that's not what Paul says. Paul says it's optional. It would hurt him. Just don't eat it. In that circumstance. Now, if an informant doesn't say anything, here's looking at you. Go ahead, gobble. But in that one particular circumstance. Now, having made the point that abstaining in such situations is not a matter of the Christian's conscience. You see, the Christian's conscience, the fact is, you can eat whatever. Food per se is not taboo, so it's not a matter of the Christian's conscience. You're doing it to bless this informant who mistakenly thinks it's a matter of your conscience. You're doing it for him. And having made the point that abstaining is not a matter of the Christian's conscience. Paul, in the second part of verse 29 and verse 30, he turns the discussion to his own situation with the rhetorical question, for why should my freedom be determined by the conscience of another? And the understood answer is that, well, it shouldn't be. Your freedom shouldn't be determined by the conscience of another, but that's precisely what they were doing. That's what they were doing in holding Paul to the limits of the person's conscience to whom Paul had voluntarily deferred. You see, because Paul deferred, abstained, voluntarily as an accommodation, they were then taking that and sticking that on him. His abstaining at some pagan dinners, purely as an accommodation for the good of other people. And that's a concept they seem to have trouble grasping. They had trouble grasping that. He did it not because he had any moral qualms about eating the food. So you're taking his accommodation, his relinquishing an entitlement, and you're holding him then to the conscience of that other person. And saying, now look, Paul, you're abstaining here, but not here. You have conscience qualms here, but not here. And Paul's going, I don't have conscience qualms. I don't. I'm abstaining for the other person. So how do you wind up restricting me in that case? That's what I think Paul is saying. Now, that being so, there was no justification for their charge of hypocrisy, their reviling of Paul for eating sacrificial meat on other occasions. Oh, yeah, you were over here and you wouldn't do it. Oh, you were all so big and proper, but now over here, blah, blah. Right? And Paul's just sitting there going, what is it you don't get? I'm trying to explain this to you. Why, it is not hypocrisy on my part. It is love on my part that is motivating me. See, so Paul, see, when properly understood, Paul's actions were perfectly consistent. He always believed it was permissible to eat the meat. He simply decided that on occasions, it was not expedient to do so. And he asked in verse 30, if I partake with gratitude, meaning with a conviction that it has been provided by God for his eating, if I partake with gratitude, why am I reviled because of that for which I give thanks? Paul is just saying, you know, you guys have gotten so turned around, you're just really missing the boat. Then he says in 10:31 to 11:1, the conclusion there is that whatever optional conduct in which a Christian might engage, whatever the optional conduct in which a Christian might engage, whether eating, drinking, or anything else, it must be done to the glory of God. Meaning it must be done in a way that brings God glory, honor, and praise. An important aspect of this is to avoid, an important aspect of doing it to the honor of God in a way that brings glory, honor, and praise to God. An important aspect of that is doing it in a way so as to avoid being a stumbling block, whether to Jews, whether to Greeks, or to the church of God. A Christian is not to use his or her freedom in such a way that it hinders someone else's hearing the gospel or alienates somebody who's already a brother or sister, because it's optional. Why do you want to use your optional conduct to hurt other people? And that's what Paul is telling them. See, as with Paul, our concern for the salvation of others, that is to control our exercise of freedom. And in that, see, in that, we are to imitate Paul as he imitates Christ. His focus is on other people. And so in restricting his freedom to bless other people, imitate him as he in that is imitating Christ. All right, now we move into the next section. Chapters 11, really 11:2 through 14, Paul turns his attention to questions and issues in the assembly, in the Christian worship assembly. Now here I want to talk, I'm not going to get to the text today. I may not even get through my preliminary remarks today. 11:2 to 16 can be confusing. But here I give you how I look at it, maintaining cultural sexual distinctions in attire. That's what I think is being said there. But let me give you some preliminary comments, remarks, that I hope it will lay out for you how I see this section. So when we get to the section, I can walk through the text fairly quickly. But there are some points I want to make about this that I think will be useful in that regard. Now, the impropriety that is involved in 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 11, verses 2 through 16, is not women praying and prophesying, but they're doing so uncovered. Paul doesn't suggest that the women should not pray or prophesy. He says only that they must be covered when they engage in those activities. So it's clear to me, and it's clear to virtually all commentators on the book, that Christian women were indeed authorized to pray and prophesy publicly in some setting. They were authorized to pray and prophesy publicly in some setting. That makes it easier to understand how removing the head covering, which I take to be a culturally expected piece of female attire. Now, there are debates about that. There are debates about many things through here, and I can't chase all of them. I'm just giving you how I understand this. Okay, I take this to be a culturally expected piece of female attire, and it makes it easier to understand how removing that covering had become an issue. Public speaking in that day and age was largely a male activity. If women in Christ were authorized to pray and prophesy publicly, well, you can see how that authorization would feed the notion that we've already seen in Corinth that sex distinctions were no longer relevant for Christians. You see, they've entered the new age of the Spirit. You remember in chapter 7? This idea, well, we've already entered the new age of the Spirit. We're now like the angels. Well, see, they easily then could interpret the fact that as Christians, they were authorized to engage in traditionally male activity of public speaking as supporting their view that sex distinctions are obsolete. So it makes sense how you can get there. For those women who believe that male-female differences were indeed irrelevant in the church, it would make sense for them to seek to discard the cultural symbols of sex distinction. Because we're convinced that those distinctions are passé. So it would make sense for them to want to discard those distinctions. Since sex distinctions, in their view, were no longer relevant, neither were items of apparel that marked those differences. Right? You see how the idea would develop. In Christ, they were free to pray and prophesy publicly. That's how men prayed and prophesied. So in Christ, we're free to pray and prophesy as men, which meant without the covering that distinguished them. All right, now a question we wish Paul had answered clearly is where the women were authorized to pray and prophesy. More specifically, we want to know whether either or both of those activities were authorized in the worship assembly. But Paul is not here concerned with the issue of what public forums were appropriate for women to pray and prophesy. His point is that wherever that speech is appropriate, something he previously would have passed on to them, it's appropriate only if done with the covering, with the cultural mark of femaleness. So we're left to do some detective work. Okay? We're left to do some detective work on what is Paul. And people who do this detective work, they come to different conclusions in that process. All right, so I'm not going to go through all the possibilities. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to tell you how I see things. Okay? Let me get through the preliminary comments before you decide to stone me. Okay? Now you'll see at the end that the practical implication of what I'm saying is not as radical as it may sound at first. And if you think my understanding is flawed, which it may be, if you think it's flawed, then by all means, reject it. Okay? But I'm telling you how I see it. I'm just a sinful guy doing his best to understand what God has written. And I'm going to give that to you, and you do with it what you will. Now, it seems to me that at least some of the female speech Paul is addressing in chapter 11, verses 2 to 16, took place in the worship assembly. At least some of it did. Now, this is suggested to me and to most commentators by three lines of evidence. The first is that chapter 11, verses 17 through 34, that section, the immediately following section, it deals with an assembly in which the Lord's Supper is shared. So that's clearly a reference to a gathering of the church for worship on the Lord's Day. Now, not only is there no hint of a change in context or setting between 2:16 and 17:34, you have parallel language in 11:2 and 17 about, I praise you, I do not praise you. In this I praise you, in this I do not praise you. You have this parallel language that suggests some type of connection between the two sections. So that's first. Secondly, in chapter 11, verse 10, you have this statement, this phrase, on account of the angels. Now, there's different understandings of what that is. But in my judgment, that's best understood as a reference to angelic oversight of the worship assembly of the people of God. Angels were said to be present at the community gatherings at Qumran. You know, the Essene community where we get the Dead Sea Scrolls from? Angels were said to be present at those gatherings, and certain people there, specifically those with a bodily defect, they were excluded from the assembly, it says, out of reverence for the angels. So this is not unusual in first century Jewish environment, the idea that angels are in fact particularly interested. Ooh, that's too bad. Particularly interested in the assembly and the worship. Now, when Paul appeals, thirdly, is when Paul appeals to the practice of the churches in 14:33b, he clearly does so with reference to the gathering of the whole church for worship. He makes a similar appeal in chapter 11, verse 16. Okay, so I am convinced, as are virtually all commentators, I am convinced that at least some of the female speech that Paul is addressing in 11:2 through 16 took place in the worship assembly. Now, if you're on the ball, you're saying, wait a minute. 1 Corinthians 14, 33b through 36, that forbids any kind of female speech in the assembly. Paul there commands women to be silent. So neither female praying nor prophesying could have taken place in the worship assembly. But as you will hear when we get to 1 Corinthians 14, I don't believe 1 Corinthians 14, 33b through 36, I don't believe that is a blanket prohibition against female speech in the assembly. In the context, and it seems quite clear to me from the context, as I will labor to explain as we go through it, in the context, I believe Paul in 1 Corinthians 14 says that women are forbidden from participating in the prophetic process. They are forbidden from participating in the prophetic process in the assembly. Okay, meaning they can neither prophesy nor challenge, weigh the prophecies delivered by others. And the rationale for that prohibition is the same as in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 11 to 14. Sarah, where women in the assembly are to express their divinely ordered submissiveness to men by refraining from authoritative speech. By refraining from authoritative speech. See, I think that's the key. In other words, in the assembly, in this holy convocation, this gathering, where the community comes together before God to worship Him, in the assembly, women are not to direct men. They are not to set them straight by delivering God's authoritative message to them. Women are forbidden from doing that, either directly by prophesying or teaching, or indirectly by challenging the prophecies or teaching of others. Now, I know this rankles some people. This difference in roles rankles some. I understand that. But it's, you know, but this distinction, hear me, it is not because women are less intelligent, less capable, less moral. It has nothing to do with that. It is not for that reason. It is because God, in His sovereignty, chose to place the leadership responsibility on men, and that choice is to be acknowledged and honored in this particular way in the assembly. You say, well, why? You want to say, look, why limit? Why limit prophesying and teaching in the assembly? Why limit that to males, given that some women are capable or more capable of doing it? Why limit it to males? And, you know, why not open those roles to all who are capable of performing them, regardless of sex? But you could just as well ask why God gave the tribe of Levi exclusive responsibility to care for the tabernacle. Or why He gave the family of Aaron exclusive responsibility to serve as priests. Why limit those roles to people who happen to be born in a certain lineage, rather than allowing everyone equal access to those roles based on ability? Certainly there were people in other tribes who could carry tabernacle furnishings as well as the Levites. You don't think they had some buff guys in the other tribes who could carry those things? Certainly they could carry them, right? Well, the answer is that it was God's sovereign choice to do so. That's the answer. And the refusal to accept God's right to restrict roles to specific groups, that refusal is precisely what led to Korah's rebellion in Numbers 16. Korah, as you remember, I hope, Korah, a Levite, and 250 community leaders, they opposed Moses and Aaron on the basis they should have equal access to God. All Israel was holy. All Israel was holy. So no one family line should be exalted to the priestly function. It was a challenge to God's right to choose select groups for specific roles. And as you know, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram were swallowed by the earth, and the 250 were incinerated by God. Okay? So that was God's answer to this challenge of His right to restrict certain roles to specific groups. Well, He has chosen men to be the leaders. Now, did I miss the second bill? Oh, well, yeah. Bonus coverage. Thanks for coming.